In the meantime, while we're transitioning, I'm wondering if we have people here who are running for office. I know that we have Dean Phillips and we have Adam Jennings both here. If you are running for office, any office, city council person, school board, could you just stand up so that we could applaud you?
Okay, it's fine, we can just pass on. Okay, could you guys just go down and introduce yourself, your school, and why you're here today?
Yeah, so my name is John Lintome, and I go to the Academy of Holy Angels, which is in Richfield, but I live in Eden Prairie. And I'm here because I'm tired of my voice not being heard. I come from a family that is very Republican, and guns have been a part of my life ever since I was young. We own several guns, and my family likes to use them when they go like at shooting ranges and stuff like that. And I've always not really understood what their need for that was. And my opinions are met with deaf ears around them. And so I want my voice on these issues to be heard by people who are actually receptive to listening.
Hi again, I'm Aberdeen Morrow. I'm a senior at Minnetonka High School. And I'm here because student voices have been silent for too long, and I think that the past couple presidents have left us in security and in safe places with gun reform, but now we are in a place when we need to take action, and the issue is heightening and we need to change.
Hi, I'm Sydney Lewis. I'm a sophomore at Eden Prairie High School, and I wanted to be on the panel today because to me, this issue isn't something that you can do just by saying, oh, I support this. Oh, I'm gonna go to this event. This is something you need to really immerse yourself in and be a part of.
Hi, I'm Eleanor. I'm a freshman at Minnetonka, and I'm here because I'm sick of the money in politics, influencing politicians. I'm sick of the police brutality, and I'm sick of the school shootings and the enormous amount of them.
Hi, I am Ian Fegler. I'm a senior at Hopkins High School. And so I'm here because I think, bottom line, I just was tired. I was tired of turning on the TV and watching kids get loaded into body bags. I was tired of watching candlelight vigils, and I was tired of watching funerals on TV. So I decided, you know, it's easy to stand by and say, you know, this is wrong. We should be doing something. But for change to happen, it takes good people to finally stand up. So that's what I'm doing up here for you guys.
Hi, I'm Saranya. I'm a senior at Maple Grove Senior High School. And I'm here because I strongly believe that more guns are not the answer to our problem. And I want to see less thoughts and prayer and more real policy change.
Hi, my name is Nahili Abdullahi, and I'm a sophomore at Chapel Park High School. And I wanted to be a part of this panel because I believe that in matters pertaining to this, that one student's voice can truly make a difference.
Okay, I know that Lori brought this up, but how do you guys feel about Paulson tweeting about hockey highlights instead of being at the town hall tonight?
Like almost everything he's done for the past years while he's in office, he showed that he doesn't really care about what people in this district think, and he just wants to stay in D.C. and continue making money and not listen to his constituents.
You want us all to answer? Yeah, I mean, I think we all
feel pretty much the same way. Not cool, dude. I've sent in a couple requests for him to be here and just to make other meetings. And this is the first time he emailed me back, and he emailed me back yesterday, and he said, oh, he's busy. Mr. Paulson has booked tomorrow.
Well, his title is representative, and I feel like... I think to represent a group of people, you have to talk to them and know how they should be representing them. So I'm gonna go with, let's vote him out this November.
Off of what Sydney said, it just makes me glad that we're working to vote him out and get other people in office in our district. And I'm honestly not too surprised because he doesn't care about his constituents.
If Eric Paulson was here, I think I would say to him that, sir, as much as I appreciate your conference call town halls, really great. Your lack of accountability is frankly indicative of a larger problem that we have in our country right now, and you frankly don't deserve to be sitting in your seat at Congress.
Paulson is our representative, and he is too scared to be here right now, and that goes to show in itself.
I'd just like to take a moment to look at the irony of the fact that we saw the email right now at this event. That's pretty great, first of all. But I just want to take a moment to really, truly realize that if he believes a hockey match is more important than looking at the lives of students, looking at our opinions, then what's the point?
Okay, so I know the old Osseo school board chair floated the idea of arming teachers or having armed volunteers patrol the hallways. How would you guys feel if you walked in and you saw someone in the hallway holding a gun, or your teachers just having guns in classrooms?
School is a place of learning, and guns should not be something that is in that environment. A gun is seen as something that is dangerous, and it implies that there's something that could happen that would put people's lives in danger, and I go to school to learn, not to be scared every day.
I mean, if you look at all the statistics, having more guns in a place does not decrease the gun violence. I saw a poster at the March for Our Lives that said, the only way to stop a good guy with a gun is a bad guy with a gun. Sounds like someone trying to sell two guns.
If you don't even think about the idea of it being, of teachers having guns, if you think about the practicality of it, our government's money could go to so many better things in public schools than arming teachers. I talked to my English teacher, she told me, she said, buy me paper, buy me pencils, buy me markers, buy me all of these supplies, don't make me carry a gun, because it's not my responsibility.
I know personally I'm a person of privilege, and walking in to see a gun with my teacher with a gun would not be nearly as frightening to me as it would be to a student of color who is far more likely to be racially profiled. And when there's guns in schools, the threat of racial profiling in school gets so much higher. It's not just getting suspended more often, which is a huge issue in its own, but with guns, it can be an issue of life or death.
Do you think you could give the mic to Nahili so she could talk more about how, as a person of color, she might feel in a setting where teachers might be armed?
Yeah.
Hi, everyone. Now, I personally cannot speak for every black person or every person of color, and I've never had to deal with any sort of violence in my life. However, as a human being, I do have empathy, And I do feel the pain of mothers, daughters, brothers, and all the people that have lost valuable friends and family members due to gun violence. It's just the principle of the matter. African Americans and minorities are discriminated upon just by their appearance, not how they think or feel. But please, look at me for a moment, sitting here on the panel voicing my opinion on this matter, and tell me, what's the difference between you and I? What's the deciding factor that makes it 10 times more likely that I would be shot than another one of my fellow panelists? I think that's all I have to say on the matter for now. Thank you.
Aside from arming teachers, MSD recently implemented clear backpacks. Do you guys think these and installing metal detectors, do you think those would be effective measures to keep students safe in schools?
Right now, what I'm thinking is that instead of addressing the matter of criminals being given the means to kill or take the lives of the innocent, we're truthfully treating the innocent as if they are the criminals by trying to implement those things into the school system. I don't believe that implementing these scare tactics will have a positive impact. I believe that facing the problem head on by applying a firm hand to gun control is the true solution in and of itself. I also think that we as a society should become more inclusive of each other. Why should there be two different sides to this one problem? Black, white, Asian, Latino, we are all humans and we all live in this country, so we as people should unite and take a stand.
Yeah, I think that we need to address the root of the problem, which is guns. Like, there's a lot of reasons why advocates of guns in general are saying that like gun violence is happening, but 100% of gun violence is associated with guns and tackling that. And tackling that with background checks, raising the minimum age, banning bump stocks and assault rifles, and real policy change will ultimately be what creates safer environments for students.
All right, I'm gonna be the dissenting opinion. So I think, first of all, they're absolutely right. If we think about gun violence in this country as a disease, unfortunately, our government is focused on treatment and not on prevention. And we should have a systemic shift in how we look at this problem. But that being said, we still do need treatment. I think it can be easy for us to get up here and say, hey, we wanna be safer. But then we have to be willing to take ideas on how to make that happen. So for me, I think that while maybe it would make me a little bit more comfortable, I think at some level we do have to start being willing to implement some school safety measures and clear backpacks and metal detectors. That might be a place to start.
I agree as well, but that it's a we need to take more preventative steps, but I also believe that some of those, I strongly support gun control, and when we bring up other options on top of that, I think another one we need to consider other than metal detectors and clear backpacks is the culture we have in America that creates this like need for guns and this want for guns that you don't see in many other countries.
A student at Marjorie Stoneman Douglas created an Instagram account with all of the students' responses to the clear backpacks, and it's one of the best things I've ever seen. It's called MSD Camo 2, and they clearly think that clear backpacks are not the way to go. They're not going to solve this problem. Like they said, that's a treatment, and we need to prevent it from ever even happening. Clear backpacks should never even have to be a thought that crosses through school districts' minds.
My favorite post from that account is a kid who stuck his real backpack into the clear backpack. And you can still get things into school in a clear backpack. So I think they're band-aids for a problem that's much bigger than this, and we need to acknowledge the size of it.
I agree with a lot of what has been said, but one more thing as far as preventing the issue. In a lot of schools, there isn't a lot of support for mental health initiatives, and that's an important problem in this country, especially for the youth. And providing assistance to kids in schools who are struggling with these issues and may not have anywhere else to go is an important way to increase health in schools and to perhaps prevent tragedies like Parkland from happening.
I know this was kind of brought up when you guys were answering the question, but what kind of measures do you think that your elected officials and future legislatures or future legislators should focus on when talking about gun reform?
Implementing universal background checks and closing loopholes like the gun show loophole, as well as banning assault rifles.
Okay, so Minnesota has, Eric Paulson's been our rep for a while, so it shows that we're kind of a little red. But how do you guys think that we can talk about gun reform in a bipartisan way?
I don't think this is at all a partisan manner, or problem, not manner. I go to a pretty conservative school. We have, there are people walking through the hallways with Hillary for President shirts on walkout day. But we still have to be able to converse with those people because gun violence doesn't just affect Democrats. And it's not only Republicans who have guns, and I don't think it's fair to partisanize this issue.
My stance is really that I acknowledge that I don't have the solution to this issue. There's not just one answer that's going to solve the entire problem, but there is solutions that are out there. The issue is that we aren't even working towards them. We're letting this issue divide us more. And when we do that, nothing will get accomplished, and these school shootings will just become a regular thing, even though they kind of already have. But we need to all come together and find that solution instead of just letting it divide us more.
Yeah, I go to Minnetonka as well, which tends to be a more conservative school, but the numbers we had at the walkout were overwhelming. And it was amazing because it wasn't just specifically for gun control, it was just anyone who wanted to see change. And everyone wants to see change in this country, and so we need to see that happen. So that's how it's going with my first.
So I'm gonna speak to what would I like to see my members of Congress doing. So I think it can be lost sometimes that gun violence is an incredibly complex issue that requires nuanced solutions. And I think something that needs to be on the forefront of our minds is that we should just acknowledge that gun violence has become a public health crisis. And if we do that, it becomes baffling to think about why we aren't letting our public health organizations research this issue, specifically the CDC. So we need to immediately expedite that process and get some research going on that. And then I think another thing we need to focus on is that there are some elements of the gun violence conversation that are frankly very uncomfortable for certain people to have, including me. And one of those is that for a lot of gun violence, we're seeing it in communities that are underprivileged with primarily people of color, and that can be related to gang violence. And we need to figure out how to have those conversations in a comfortable and constructive way. And I think that can help us figure out some solutions.
So on the issue of partisanship, I think that that actually has nothing to do with it. One of the most common misconceptions is that law-abiding citizens are gonna have their guns taken away, and that's simply false, because the only guns that are being taken away are those, are for people who don't deserve them in the first place, which is why we should have background checks, and everyone should be supporting it, because safety should not be a debatable topic.
So to approach this matter in a bipartisan way, I think we just need to look at facts. BBC found that in 2015, there were 372 mass shootings in the United States alone. That is an overwhelming amount, and definitely shouldn't even be possible to have that many in one country. I think that alone should be a reason for the two parties to be able to come to a mutual understanding concerning the topic of gun control. what's it like being a student fighting for gun reform, and what is one or two things that you want the adults in the room to know, and like how they could help you in that fight?
So I think that there are a multitude of positive and negative impacts of being a student fighting for gun control. One of the positive effects that it has had was that it gave our generation a feeling of empowerment, a feeling that we can stand up for our own rights and we can do anything that we put our minds to. I think a negative drawback to this was the fact that it just brought the actuality of real life into our minds. It made us come to the realization that this is the world we live in and that we have to fight for our own lives, and that sometimes not everybody will be for us. They'll be for money or for things that don't matter as much as the life of an actual human being.
I think fighting for gun control as a student is definitely challenging. I actually recently watched a video on Facebook that showed clips of what Fox News aired after the March for Our Lives protest. And it was filled with people saying that we didn't know what we were talking about, and somehow we weren't creating actual change. But my question is, this is the first time in such a great like number that we've gotten to create change. So how are we not creating an impact, and why do we not have the voice when other people aren't doing it for us? Yeah, but otherwise the response has been great, just because we are students and people see that, and they're open to, a lot of people are open to seeing us and what we have to say.
I think for so long in politics, young people were kind of this slumbering giant, this slumbering monster. And finally, it took a series of tragedies, but that kind of political power is starting to wake up and we're starting to get more active. So, yeah, that's pretty cool. So I guess just for the adults in the room, I think I want to thank you guys so much for saying, like, for welcoming us and for allowing us this platform. So keep being supportive and keep welcoming us in, and together we're going to do some great things.
I believe one of the biggest positives is that students who were not really caring about politics in the past are realizing that this gun control issue affects them. And once they start researching this issue, they start looking into other issues, because this issue connects to other ones. It connects to the racism in our country. It connects to the sexism and toxic masculinity in our country. And if it relates to the campaign finance issues in this country. As students start learning more about that, they learn more about these other issues and they become more involved, and I believe that we'll see a lot more activism for my generation starting with this gun control debate.
Well, this fight is our generation's issue, our whole generation. This is going to be what we're remembered as, is the fighting gun violence in schools generation, which kind of stinks. But I think the main thing that we can ask the adults to do is show us that you support us and get out and vote for people who, if they aren't showing up at town halls, or or if they aren't listening to us, or they aren't showing that they are going to support this issue, then we need to vote them out of office and keep people in office who are going to support us.
I've had a lot of conversations with conservative friends. I have one particular friend who said that she wasn't walking out because she's branded herself as a conservative, and so that doesn't quite align with her reputation that she wants to preserve. And then we started talking about the actual issues and what solutions to this gun violence problem is, and we actually agree on a lot of the same things. So I think that ultimately it's having those hard conversations with people, but obviously most of you in this room are going to vote against gun violence. And so I think we need to continue to have conversations with people who might not be in that position yet. And so to the adults in the room, there are a lot of you, and we need your help to convert people to stand with us at the polls in November.
Being a student opposing gun violence has been a really inspiring experience for me. I remember when my school went to one of the walkouts, we got out in the middle of the day, and I have like 600 kids who go to my school, and there's probably 400 or more of them actually went to the Capitol March. And then about 1,000 more kids showed up from other schools, and we all just marched to the Capitol, and it was a very unifying feeling. Everybody together there supporting the same thing, and we all wanted safer schools. And so I've been very inspired by this, and I hope that that inspiration has been something that is spread from the students to their parents into the whole community, and that especially in November we can show people that this is something that we really care about and we're not going to be quiet about anymore, and people will vote against politicians who support or who do not support gun control and vote them out of office.
Thank you. Oh.